Good morning, church. How's everybody doing? Turn to your neighbor and say, welcome. We're so glad that you're here worshiping with us today. I know there's a lot of folks online, a lot of folks traveling, but it's a great day, and we're so glad to see each of you. I want to say Happy Father's Day, and so go ahead and turn to one of the men in your life and say Happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day. We know that Father's Day is a huge day. We value and love all of our fathers and all of our men. Also know that Father's Day might be a little difficult for some of us, but we just want to let you know that we love you and we encourage you through that. Simply put, fathers are important. I wanted to share just a few things with you this morning. Over 25% of kids today in America grow up without a father in their home. And almost every social issue in our country can be linked back to the father not being in the house. So today we honor the impact of our fathers. We thank you, men and fathers, for stepping up and leading by example. And we also, as a church, want to affirm God's view of biblical fatherhood and how important that is. And we encourage all men, no matter who you are, how many kids you have, or if you don't have kids at all, to step up and become spiritual fathers in the lives of young people. Isaiah 1:17 says, learn to do right, seek justice, defend the oppressed, take up the cause of the fatherless. Dads, you're valued today and every day. I know Mother's Day, we usually go out and do something nice. I hope that you're not stuck on the grill today. But if you are, enjoy your family, and thanks for being here. Hey, if you're visiting with us, do me a favor, take out this card in front of you and fill it out, and you can give it to me. I'll be at the guest central desk at the end of services this morning. We're excited to worship God together, and we're going to do that right after our kids' church video.
Saul, who was also known by his Roman name, Paul, was with the church in Antioch. The Holy Spirit chose Paul and another believer, Barnabas, for a special work. So they obeyed and left Antioch. God led Paul and Barnabas to tell the good news about Jesus to not only the Jews, but the Gentiles, or people who were not Jews. Paul and Barnabas traveled to Lystra. Paul healed a man there who had never been able to walk. The people saw what Paul had done, and they thought Paul and Barnabas were gods. They began to worship them, but Paul and Barnabas tore their clothes and shouted, "No, we are not gods, we are men. Just like you, we want to tell you the good news of God." Then some people showed up from Antioch and Iconium, cities where Paul and Barnabas had preached about Jesus. These people caused trouble so that the people in Lystra turned against Paul and Barnabas too. They threw stones at Paul and dragged him out of the city. They thought he was dead, but the believers in Lystra gathered around Paul. He got up. The next day, Paul and Barnabas went to the city of Derbe. They told people there about Jesus, and many people believed. Then Paul and Barnabas went back to Lystra and to Iconium. They encouraged the believers there to continue in the faith. They told the believers that they would face suffering because they believed in Jesus. Paul and Barnabas also chose leaders for the churches. Finally, Paul and Barnabas returned to the church in Antioch. They reported everything God had done on their journey and how God had helped them share the good news with the Gentiles. Many people rejected the good news about Jesus, but God had a plan for Paul to share the gospel with the Gentiles, no matter what troubles he faced. Many believed in Jesus. The church grew and the gospel spread so that people all over the world could be saved from their sin by trusting in Jesus.
Father in heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people declare your mighty works, blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore. Father in heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people declare your mighty works, blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore. I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Oh, the pure delight of a single hour that before thy throne I spend. When I kneel in prayer and with thee, my God, I commune as friend with friend. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. There are depths of love that I cannot know till I cross the narrow sea. There are heights of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side.
Please bow with me, church. Lord God, we come before you today so thankful that we're able to gather here as a congregation. I ask that as we go into this service, you just open our hearts and minds to the wonderful sermon you have in store for us, Lord. I ask that as we come away from this place of worship, that you just keep our minds set on you and that you give us the strength to take what we learn here today into the rest of the week. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please stand with me as we sing this song before.
I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemy. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord.
You may be seated.
Good morning, everyone. Truly, it's a blessing once again to be in God's house to hear yet another portion of his word. I know it's not usual that you see me 2 weeks in a row, but me and my wife will be traveling on Monday. We're heading to our granddaughter's graduation from high school. The amazing part about that is that the very high school that she's graduating from, I graduated from back in 1970. So there's 52 years of Connors going to Burlington Township High School. All of my siblings graduated from there. All of our children graduated from there. Now all of our grandchildren have graduated from there. That's just amazing, amen? That's just amazing. Never back in 1970 would I have ever thought that my granddaughter and all my grandchildren would graduate from the high school that I graduated from. It's just amazing to me. So it's a lot of years. And the school's still standing. There's been a number of generations of Connors who have went through there, and thank God she's the last one to come out. She's the last one to come out. So we'll be traveling on Monday. Please keep us in your prayers that we make it there safely. Pray for our daughters also. They'll be traveling also up to New Jersey on tomorrow. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers. Happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day. A great day. I told you last month when Mother's Day was that you had to make a reservation to go somewhere. Today you can go anywhere. No reservation is needed. Just like B said, if you're out on the grill, if you're stuck out on the grill, then enjoy yourself out on the grill. But it's just a great day. As a matter of fact, I sent out my Happy Father's Day salutes to a lot of people that I know, and one of my buddies texted me back, and he sent me this picture that showed on Mother's Day, there was a table with a bottle of wine, a really nice dinner set up, sitting on like a dock where the ocean was. Beautiful. Then on Father's Day, he showed a TV dinner. Turn with me in your Bibles this morning to Jeremiah chapter 18. Jeremiah chapter 18. Thankful to the brethren who have participated in the worship this morning. Also thank Brother Bernard for allowing me to switch with him on these weekends to be able to bring you the word on today. Jeremiah chapter 18, starting at the first verse. The Bible reads, The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause thee to hear my words. Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrought a work on the wheels. And the vessel that was made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. So he made it again another vessel, as seemed good to the potter to make it. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, O house of Israel, cannot I do with you as this potter, saith the Lord? Behold, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are ye in my hand, O house of Israel. Is that in your word this morning? God uses many images to describe his relationship to his people. He speaks of the shepherd and the sheep relationship, the husband and wife relationship, a father and his children, and that's just to name a few. All of these are wonderful, and they teach us many, many valuable lessons about life. They teach us about ourselves, and they teach us about the Lord. However, while we like sheep are protected and provided for by the shepherd, and as a wife, she is loved and without condition by her husband, and like children who are constantly under the father's loving watch, there's another aspect of our lives that needs to be factored into that equation. After all, Jesus did not save us from our sins just so we could go to heaven and avoid hell. He saved our souls that we might be actively involved and actively engaged in his service here on the earth. Now, if we are to be his servants, we are going to need his power to get the job done. Never let the child of God think that you're doing this underneath your own power. If you're working for the Lord, you need God's power. John chapter 15, verse number 5 makes our dependence upon Jesus very clear. For he says, I am the vine and ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, he says, you can do nothing. Therefore, perhaps one of the greatest portraits of God and his people are to be found in the entire Bible. Related to this matter of service is the picture of the potter and the clay. In these brief verses, we can see the plan of the Heavenly Father on display. So let's take a few minutes on this morning and look into these verses together as we consider the subject for this morning, lessons from the potter's house. Lessons from the potter's house. First of all, the potter has a singular intention. The potter has a singular purpose. He plans to take clay and from that clay, he plans to produce vessels. He wants to make vessels that will reap a profit, those that can be found useful and that will bring honor unto him. The pieces he manufactures are intended to be used by him and by others. This is God's intention as well. He excels in taking old worthless clay and transforming it by his grace into vessels of honor and glory. He takes those things that are the off scourge of all things and he turns them into vessels of honor. Jesus saves the sinner by his grace, and then he begins the process of changing that vile sinner into a vessel that will produce a profit for the kingdom of God. One that will be useful to him in his work and one that will bring honor and glory to his name. God is interested in taking the worst that he can find and changing it into the best heaven has to offer. Amen, somebody. Psalm 139, verses 23 through 24. Psalm 139, verses 23 through 24. Now, all of us should actually take a good look at this psalm and realize that this psalm is what we should live by every day. Notice what it says. Search me, O Lord, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Now you have to, if you're asking God to search you, you want God to take a look at everything that's going on inside your life, the way that you react, the way that you talk, the way that you are when everybody's not around you. He says, search me and know my heart and try me and know my thoughts and see if there be any wicked way in me. Now I know in the Church of Christ there are no wicked people, but we're asking if there's any wicked way in us. So the potter, in order to accomplish this lofty goal, the potter must work with materials that leave much to be desired. So it's the condition of the clay as it is found. Clay, as it is found in the ground, is not suitable for use. It is dug out of the ground and brought to the vicinity of the pottery and allowed to weather for weeks. The dry material is then dumped into a cement-lined tank and wooden trough and covered with water. When the lumps have softened, they are stirred in the water until all have disintegrated. Stay with me now. And then a thin, slimy mud or a slip has been formed. In coast cities, the potteries are all near the sea, as the seawater is considered better for the slipping process. That's to make the clay the way that it needs to be. See, the slip is then drawn off into settling tanks. All stones and lumps remain behind, and when the clay has settled, the water is drawn off and the plastic-like material is worked by treading with the feet. The prepared clay is finally packed away and allowed to stand for another 6 months before being used, and during which time the quality, especially the plasticity, is believed to improve. In other words, the clay as it is taken from the ground is worthless. It must be transformed into a usable state. And this is a process that takes time and energy on the part of the potter. Stay with me. I'm gonna be where I need to be in just a few minutes. Is that all right? This is a perfect portrait of those lost in sin. We are worthless to God in our natural condition. However, he is able to see the vessels that we can become. Therefore, he begins the process that will bring us to a place of usefulness. He digs us out, washes us clean, and he dries us up. Amen, somebody. This is a clear picture of a process a sinner must go through prior to his salvation. The heart is pricked, and the conviction of God begins to work in the heart. The sinner is long in little baby steps until he reaches the place where he receives Christ as his Savior. At that point, God begins the molding process. Sinner into the saints that we are right now. And it seems pretty evident that the Lord doesn't have a whole lot to work with when he finds us. After all, we are all made from the same clay. Y'all with me this morning? We're all made from the same clay. God has to form each and every one of us. Am I right about it? God has to take each and every one of us and he has to transform us. He has to make us the way that he wants us to be. So the potter uses several instruments to bring the clay to a place where it's usable. First of all, he uses a shovel. This is the tool he uses to dig the clay from the earth. This is a picture of the Spirit of God who comes to where we are in sin and speaks to us in convicting power and draws us to Jesus. Now, the Holy Spirit will convict you, and it will make you do what you need to do. When I joined the church years ago, when I became a member of the body of Christ years ago, I stopped going to church for a little while, and I tried hiding from everybody that was in the church. I'd see somebody from the church, I'd go the other way. Anybody with me this morning? Till I was sitting on a porch one day on a street, and one of the brothers from the church that I knew very well and loved him very much, Brother Brown, I happened to see him coming down the street where I was sitting. I don't know how he got there, but he saw me. And guess what? I was sitting on the porch, and there was nowhere for me to run or hide. So he walked right up on me, and he said, Wayne, how come you don't come to church anymore? And I was convicted right there on that spot. And I said, Brother Brown, I'll start coming back to church. And from that day until this, I've never stopped. But it was just that convicting moment right there where the Holy Spirit worked in him and worked in me in order to get me back into the church that I thought I could hide and run from everybody. Let me tell you, church, you can't hide and run from God. You can't get away from him. Didn't Jonah find that out? Jonah thought that he could jump ship and he didn't want to do what God wanted him to do. He thought he could do it. He thought that he could get away. Guess what? God sees you no matter where you are. There's no rock big enough for you to hide under. So praise the Lord for the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said it best when he spoke to Saul on the Damascus Road in Acts chapter 9, verse number 5. He said, it's hard for thee to kick against the pricks. This may be where some of us are at right now. And if the potter is digging around in your life, he is calling you to come to him. Please do it today. You'll never regret it. How many of you this morning regret being a child of God? I better not see one hand. You got to love the decision you made. Am I right about it? You've got to love the fact that you decided to come to the Lord. Guess what? That is the best decision any one of us has ever made. Now, after the shovel, he also needs a mallet. The clay has been cleansed, and after the clay has been cleansed and processed, it is placed on a table and beaten with a wooden mallet. The potter does this to remove any air bubbles that might be trapped inside of the clay. Stay with me now. And if he doesn't, the air bubbles will form a pocket that will produce a weak spot and cause the vessel to be fragile and unusable. This is a picture of trials and calamities and chastisements of life that tend to work together to shape us into the image of Jesus Christ. We may not like the pounding of the mallet, but its sole purpose is to make us more usable and pliable in the potter's hand. You see, the Heavenly Father is in the business of making us look like Jesus. Amen, somebody. Therefore, that beating with the mallet is a good thing. And we have to take a look at the potter. The potter uses a thing that's called a wheel. And in these wheels, there's a bigger wheel on the bottom, a larger wheel on the bottom, which is usually made of stone upon a stone shaft that sits on a stone socket. Coming out of the large stone is an upright shaft that extends some 3 feet with another smaller wheel mounted on the top. Now the potter, using his feet, spins the large wheel to make the lower wheel move. And as he does, the upper wheel is turned. This is where the clay is placed, and as the clay turns, the potter will place his hands upon it and shape it according to his will. Again, these wheels are symbolic of the circumstances and situation that lives bring our way. Life oftentimes seems like a large wheel. It seems that we just get past one trial when here comes another around the corner again. Amen, somebody. These things are hard to take and leave us confused and burdened, but we must remember that the potter controls the speed of the wheel and they only rotate according to his will. Never forget that God is always in control, regardless of what you're facing in life, and that all things are eventually going to work out to your good. Now, Romans 8, verse number 28 says, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. So that means that we got to go through some good things and we got to go through some bad things. Are y'all with me this morning? And in going through those things, all those things work together for the good. Now, let me tell you, the last couple Sundays, I got to go back further than that. The last 3 or 4 weeks, maybe just about a month, Satan has really sent some really critical blows at me. He sent some really bad blows. A couple months back, I got a little ill. Last week, my car decided that it had enough and it stopped right out here in the parking lot. This week, something happened at the house that we still got to have fixed up. But guess what? In all that, I know that all things, I know what was happening. Satan was trying to stop me from getting here this morning. He was trying to keep me from bringing this message to you. Whether you receive it the way God wants you to or not, you've got to realize Satan will throw some things in your life, will try to stop you in your tracks. And when he tries to stop you, you know what you have to do, church? You have to smile at it and keep on moving. Am I right about it? You can't let him stop you regardless of what goes on. I don't care what he throws at you. Keep on moving. Why? Because God is still in control. Regardless of what you go through, God is always in control. I don't care if it's good or sickness or whatever. God is still in control. And where we as children of God have the advantage at is that we have God as our Father, and God's only going to do good for his children. So while his hands, while the clay spins around on the wheel, it is never out of contact. It is never out of contact with the potter's hands. He is in constant contact, molding, shaping, and bringing the clay along through his loving kindness. If he were ever to remove his hand, the clay would then just spin right off the wheel and then would be lost. Therefore, he remains there with the clay and brings it along until it becomes what he desires. What a great picture of the Heavenly Father. Am I right about it, church? There are times when God seems to be remote. There are times when God seems to be removed a million miles away from us and from our needs. However, he has promised. He has promised in his word. Turn to Hebrews chapter 13, verse number 5. Hebrews chapter 13, verse number 5. Notice what the Bible says. He has promised that he will never leave us nor forsake us, and that he will ever be with his children. How many of y'all believe that this morning? How many of y'all believe that this morning? He'll never leave you nor forsake you. You have to realize, church, God is with us at all times. The child of God need never fear that the Lord will walk out on us and leave us to spin out of control. No matter how fast the wheel spin or what comes our way, we can rest assured that the Lord of glory will never remove his hands from us. He is always in touch with his clay. He's always in touch with us. And let me tell you, church, regardless of what you go through, regardless of what you deal with, God is always there. The problem with the vessel is that even in the potter's hands, and look at Jeremiah chapter 18, verse number 4, the Bible says, and the vessel that he had made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. So he made it again another vessel as seemed good to the potter to make it. Even in the potter's hands, things can still go terribly wrong. The fault is not with the potter. The fault is not with him, but it is with the clay. There are times, even when the best of care, the vessel still gets out of shape. Isn't that the way our lives seems at times? We are going along just fine. We are going in the grace of the Lord. Then along comes a temptation or a trial for one reason or other. We are thrown off balance and we become marred in the potter's hands. And every turn of the wheel makes the blemish even more visible. It soon becomes evident that God cannot use us in our present shape. Never be guilty of believing that this cannot happen to you. There are many people in this world that started out running well for the Lord, but along the way they got weak and out of balance in their lives. Before long, they were vessels of dishonor. They never planned it that way, but it happened just the same. So never think that it can't happen to you. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse number 12 says, wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. You have to realize, church, you can never look at somebody else's life and say, that will never happen to me. I'll never get there. Anything can happen inside your life. You have always got to be on guard. Am I right about it, church? You've always got to be on guard. Never look down on somebody else's situation. The best thing you can do for them is pray for them. And pray to God that it never, ever happens to you. You know, church, we got to realize there's people in the body of Christ who are going through some very, very bad times right now, even being children of God. And we as the body of Christ need to pray for them and pray them out of the situation that they're in right now and pray that God's will be done inside their lives. So when you go to pray at night, just don't pray for yourself. Pray for somebody else in the body of Christ. You have to realize your prayer, the Bible said, the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man does what? It availeth much. So we have to realize, church, in availing much, we've got to pray for those who are in need of our prayers. I pray for everybody every night. I pray for my family. I pray for the Church of Christ. I pray for those who are sick. I pray that God's will be done in each and every one's life. I just don't pray for me and my wife. I pray for everybody. When you open up that prayer, let me tell you, prayer works. How many of y'all know that? Prayer works, doesn't it? Doesn't it bring you through? Doesn't it take some of the burden off your back? Yes, it does. So we have to realize, because of his hand resting on the vessel, the potter knows instantly when a problem arises. He senses the changes in the clay and begins taking whatever steps are necessary to correct the problem. The same could be said for the Lord. There are times when we are all just cracked pots. We are all just messed up. Yet because he knows everything about us and because his hand rests on our lives, he is instantly aware when things aren't as they should be. Now, you know, the Lord knows everything about you. There's nothing about you that he doesn't know. As a matter of fact, he knows some things that you don't know. Doesn't the Bible say he knows how many hairs are on your head? How many of y'all counted your hairs? How many know how many hairs they got on? Well, you know, a lot of us have lost a lot of them. Might not be able to count, but a few up there. Am I right? But he knows how many hairs are on your head. Isn't that a loving God? He knows just what you're made of. He knows just what you're able to do. He knows what you're able to take. He says he won't put on you more than you can bear. And then again, he'll make a way of escape even through that. We have to realize God loves us just that much. And at that moment, he takes the necessary steps to get us back into a usable condition. Never think, even for a second, that you're going to hide something from the Lord. He sees it all. Look at Proverbs chapter 15 in your Bibles. Proverbs chapter 15. Oh, I just like I told you a little while ago, I told you I tried to hide from somebody. And when I tried to hide, it seemed like I was more out in the open than I was if I hid behind something. Proverbs chapter 15, look at verse number 3. Look what the Bible says. It says, the eyes of the Lord are in every place. How many of y'all believe that today? You can't hide nothing from God. The eyes of the Lord are in every place. Look what the Bible says, withholding the evil and the good. So you can't hide nothing from God. Never think that you're hiding something from God, because the Bible even says, even the nighttime is as daylight to him. He is aware of every thought, every deed, and every moment, every motive, and will allow none to pass before his gaze that is unchallenged. If God knows what I have need of, it stands to reason that he also knows when I have a sin or a flaw in my attitude that needs correction. I'm kidding myself, and I think I'm keeping a secret from the Lord. The best thing I can do is to be responsive to his touch and yield to his activities in my life. The sooner I reach the place he desires me to be, the sooner he can begin to use me for his glory. All of us should want to be used for the glory of God. Amen? All of us should want our lives to symbolize Jesus Christ inside of us. Let me tell you, church, people need to see who you are in Christ Jesus. They don't need for you to talk about it. They need to see it in action. Am I right, church? They need to see you as a child of God. And when they see you as a child of God, they can believe who God is because they can see God in you. Now, I know there's a lot of situations out there, and a lot of us go through things during the day where we let that man that died in the baptismal pool, we let him resurface every now and then. You know that guy that should have died some time ago? We let him back into our lives. So let me tell you, church, people need to see who you are, and they need... It's better to see a sermon than to hear one. Oh, y'all not hearing me this morning? It's better to see one than to hear one. People need to see how God is working in your life. Am I right about it? They need to see it. And even though the clay is misshapen and disformed, it is still in the potter's hand. The potter takes the marred vessels, presses it back into a lump, and begins again. At that time, the vessel may turn out well, but also may be deformed once again. If so, as long as the clay is moldable and pliable in his hand, the potter will rework it and reform it until he is able to produce a vessel that satisfies him. You see, as that clay turns around on the wheel, the potter has his hands on it, and he's shaping and he's molding that vessel, and he's trying to get it exactly the way he wants it to be. Sometimes he's got to reach deep down inside of it. Help me, somebody. He has to reach deep down inside of it to pull some things out of it to make sure it's smooth from the inside out. See, the outside just isn't what needs to be seen, but it needs to be smooth on the inside. It needs to look just as pretty on the inside as it does on the outside. So when he's molding and shaping our lives, we need to look just as good on our inside as we do on the outside. Or we can make the outside look good, don't we? We can make the outside look real pretty, but what about the inside? What about who you are on the inside? That's what God looks at. God doesn't worry about this. He worries about the inside. Don't you know your soul is actually who you are? All this isn't you. Your soul is in here. Oh, y'all not hearing me this morning. Y'all look at me like you never heard that before. When you die, this body goes back to the earth. It's dust. It turns back. The spirit goes back to God. But your soul, the Bible says, lives on. Your soul is actually you. So when you take a good look at it, you need to look good on the inside. Don't worry about doing the outside. Let me tell you, if you get the inside right, y'all not hear me this morning, the outside will naturally look good. Am I right about it? You get that inside right. Oh, that's changing that attitude. That's changing the way you talk. That's changing the way you act. That's being more and more Christ-like. And when we do that, we have to realize God is showing us to be vessels of honor. So again, this is a picture of the Heavenly Father in our lives. There are many times along the way that we can look back to see ourselves deformed and misshapen upon the potter's wheel. At those times, he lovingly pressed upon us his hands and begins to process once again. This process is not always pleasant. There are times when the Lord has to bring chastisement into our lives. He does this because he loves us and seeks his best in our lives. However, it isn't a pleasant thing when the Lord presses us down. When the vessel is marred, the potter does not throw the clay away and start fresh with a new piece. There's a reason for this. He has already invested too much time in salvaging the clay from the soil and in preparing it for his use. He has invested an interest in what happens to the clay. Therefore, he can't afford to be patient and keep it working in the clay until it begins to be resemble the image that he desires. By the same token, never has the Heavenly Father thrown the clay away. He has paid the ultimate price for his clay. He died to redeem it from sin and disuse. Now he is determined that he will make something special out of it. I like to think everybody here this morning is something special that God made. I like to think that everybody has a special purpose inside their lives. God made you to do something. You've got to give him the glory. Am I right, church? Now he is determined that he will make something special. Therefore, the Christian need never fear being thrown out by the potter. What God saved, God plans to keep forever. He thought you were saving. He thought you were worth saving. So he came and changed your life. He thought you were worth keeping. So he cleaned you up on the inside. He thought you were to die for. So he sacrificed his life so you could be free. So you could be whole and you could tell everybody that you know about Jesus Christ. Amen, somebody. Now I say this, there are times when the clay becomes no longer pliable to the potter's touch. When this happens, the potter has no choice but to set it aside, that hardened vessel, and choose another lump of clay with which to work. That is not a picture of losing one's salvation, but it's a picture of being shelved. There are times when the Lord removes his hands, a blessing, and places us aside and uses another vessel instead. However, we can be assured that this never happens to us as long as we are moldable and yielded to his hands. So the message about control is in verse number 6 in Jeremiah chapter 18. According to verse 6, the potter has absolute control over what becomes the clay. It is in his hands and he makes it what he desires. What a message to God's people. He is in control of our lives and he makes us of us what he wishes. Some are sturdy vessels that are used over and over again. Others are very fine and delicate like expensive china. They are used only on special occasions, but are glorious to behold at any time. And y'all remember a long time ago, your mom had a china closet. You remember those? Oh, we can't reach the millennials on that. They don't know the. Years ago, my mother had a china closet, and she had her fine china in that closet. Now, one thing as a child that you knew is that if that china was in that closet, you didn't touch it. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You didn't get near it. I mean, even if you bumped it, you better make sure you ran. That fine china was only used on special occasions. And that's what God does with some of us. Some of us are like fine china. He only uses us on special occasions. Even others might be used in ways that make them vessels of dishonor. Whatever uses, it's according to the will of the potter. And those types of choices are totally up to him. The clay, we have no right to question the potter's judgment in the matter of what kind of vessel he makes us. Isaiah chapter 45, verse number 9 says, woe unto him that striveth the maker. Let the potsherd strive with the potsherds of the earth. Shall the clay say unto him that fashioneth, what makest thou? The whole point here is that God decides what he wants you to be, what he wants each and every one of us to be. Your duty is to submit to his will. So can you honestly say today that I am totally yielded to the will of God for my life? Or would you have to say that there are areas in my life that I still like to be in control? These are the parts of me that I haven't given over to the potter. There are circumstances that I face that I still try to control and work out. Are you like putty in the potter's hand? We have to realize that our lives must be totally given to the potter. In case you don't know who I through this whole lesson, if you don't know who the potter is God. And he's molding and shaping each and every one of our lives. Now, you can't question him as to what he's doing, and you can't question him as to what you are. All you can do is give him glory and give him honor in exactly what you're doing. Many years ago in the horse and buggy day, there was a man and his wife driving along a very narrow and dangerous stretch of road. And as they got down the road, the wife got really nervous. And she reached over and she grabbed one of the reins from the husband. So they're going down the road and the husband gives her the other rein. So she says, no, I don't want both of them. I just want one of them. He said, well, listen, both of us can't drive this horse. It's either going to be me or you. So she gave the rein right back over to him, gave him the rein right back over to him, and they went along and everything was just right. My point in that is this. You can't tell God what you want to control and what he can control. There's only one that takes total control of our lives. So if you're going to give the reins to anybody, give both the reins to God and let God direct your path. Let him be the one who shows you which way you have to go. And as you fly along around the wheels of life, are you confident that God's will is being done in your life as it should be? Can you sense the hands of the Heavenly Father and patiently, lovingly mold you into his image? Are you a vessel that is refusing to wield your life here or there? There is no better time than the present than to take care of that right today. So will you come to Jesus today? Will you totally surrender your life unto him? Let me tell you, there's no better place for your life to be than in Christ Jesus. There's no better place for any of us to be than willingly giving our lives to the Lord. And even when things do spin out of control, he still has his loving hand upon you to straighten those things out. Amen, somebody? So we have to realize, church, are we those vessels that God uses for his glory and his honor? Or are we vessels of dishonor? We need to learn these lessons from the potter's house, and I guarantee your life will be that much more better. So if you're here this morning and you're outside of Christ, you've heard what the Lord has wanted you to hear. He asked you to believe what you heard this morning. Today you can come. You have to repent for the way that you've been living. Now, repentance doesn't mean that every week you come to church, you stand and ask people to pray for you. It's a turning from and a turning to. It's a turning from what you were doing and turning more to God. He has to repent for the way he's been living, confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And right now you can be baptized into Christ for the remission of your sins. What a great day. Today's Father's Day. What a great day to get baptized. What a great day to memorize, to remember the day that you got baptized. You got baptized on Father's Day. Amen, somebody. You got baptized on a day that you can remember. Now, right now, you can come down an aisle, give me your hand, give God your heart. And this morning, you can be baptized into Christ for the remission of your sins. There's one or more than one needs to answer the gospel call. As you come forward, as together we stand and together we sing.
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for the nail-pierced hands. Wash me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know, your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy is the Lamb seated on the throne. Crown you now with many crowns. You reign victorious, high and lifted up. Jesus, Son of God, the darling of heaven crucified, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for the nail-pierced hands. Wash me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know, your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy is the Lamb seated on the throne. Crown you now with many crowns. You reign victorious, high and lifted up. Jesus, Son of God, the darling of heaven crucified, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb.
Good morning, church. So today is the day that we are going to come to church. Thank you, Wayne, for that passage, just the lesson, molding us into who we are, but knowing that every day changes, and every day our walk with Jesus changes, and we want to go closer to him each and every day. Now is the time where we take part in communion, and we do this in remembrance of Jesus. One of the things I want to share to you is kind of the life that Jesus lived, and I want to sum that life up in four letters: love. There's a passage in, I believe it's Luke 22, verse 49. When Jesus' followers say what was going to happen, they said, "Lord, should we strike with our swords?" And one of them struck the servant of the high priest, cutting his right ear off. Verse 51 says, "But Jesus answered, 'No more of this,' and he touched the man's ear and healed him." Jesus was getting ready to go to the cross, and yet he still chose love. He still chose to put the man's ear back, somebody that was escorting him to the cross. See, in our lives, it's easy to love our fathers, love our mothers, love our siblings. But do we love somebody that's difficult in our lives? Do we love somebody that has wronged you? That's the question I ask today, because we see what Jesus did in Scripture time and time again. John 10:10 says, "A thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, for Jesus comes so that we may have life and life abundantly." I challenge you guys to love the one in front of you, but to also love your enemy, because that's what Jesus did. A sermon does what? Is a sermon better spoken or lived? Just went over this. It's better when it's lived out. Jesus lived a life full of love, guys. Let's pray for the bread. Father, thank you for being a good, good Father. God, we fall short each and every day, but again, you choose us. God, when we're not faithful, you're still faithful to us. God, I pray that we can say no to the good things so we can say yes to the great things. God, thank you for the blessings that you've given us each and every day. God, I pray for our hearts. I pray that we don't just come to church and listen to a great message and leave it at that. God, I pray that we go out and make disciples of all nations, baptizing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God, thank you for going to the cross to die for our sins. We pray this in your name. Amen. Luke 15 talks about the lost son, and all through growing up in church and going to church camps, it's been a very popular message, very popular passage that youth ministers will go to, because a lot of times ministers are ministering to sons, daughters, and a lot of times we're in that rebellious stage from 13 to 17, and it talks about leaving and the lost one coming back. And so part of this one is, we always think about the younger son. Sometimes we can identify with the younger son, and sometimes we can identify with the older son, the one that's like, "Dad, like, he embarrassed us. He went his own way. Like, let him be." And I think it's so cool that in this story, I think Jesus shares this because he wants to spotlight the father. Because you can put anyone in the younger son, and that father's going to do the same thing. He's going to not wait for the son to get to him, but he's going to go get the son. As we celebrate Father's Day today, I think it's so cool that we serve a good, good father. Somebody that has never left us, has never forsaken us, and he's always there. I'm sure most of you guys have heard this before, but the poem is called Footprints. A guy one time, he was struggling in life. And all throughout his life, there's usually two sets of footprints in the sand. But again, when he was struggling, he looked down, he saw that there's only one set of footprints. And this really got to him. And he went to the Father and he said, Father, when I have struggled the most is when you've left me and there's only been one set of footprints in the sand. And the Father said, Son, when there's only been one set of footprints is when I've carried you. So we serve a loving God that loves us for who we are. But again, he wants to mold us and change us as we walk with him. Let's do this and let's pray for the cup. Father God, we come before you today again. Just grateful for the congregation. Grateful for our brothers and sisters in Christ that maybe they don't see us too much. They do call us out, but they call us out because they love us. They want what's best for us. And I pray for accountability. I pray for your son, God, Jesus. Thank you for the sacrifice that you made that only you can make, God. We need to understand that you are the perfect one, God, and you're the only one that could have taken away our sins, cleansed us of our wrongdoing. Again, thank you for dying on the cross for our sins, and we pray this in your name. Amen. This is the time in our service where we give back to what already God owns. We're giving back contribution to what our church does and our local ministries, and then even around the world. And we're blessed to be a part of a church that just doesn't abide in the walls of the church, but we go out into the community. And there's different ways that you can give. You can do your contribution. There's baskets outside in the foyer, but you can also give online, and everything is up here if you guys do want to give. And I just want to say God wants a cheerful giver. And I remember when I was young, I would sit right over there with my parents and they'd always give me a dollar to put in. I was like, why do we do this every week? And at that moment, I didn't understand what they were doing, but they were preparing me to show me, hey, give with a cheerful heart. Because I always like, oh, my mom's giving me a dollar. Cool. And then I would put it in the basket. I'm like, oh. But God wants a cheerful giver. So as we give, give with a loving, cheerful heart. Let's pray. Father, thank you for, again, being a good, good father. Thank you for sending your son to set an example for a way that we need to live, somebody that we can follow, somebody with no flaws that lived a perfect life. God, he went to the cross. He could have called 10,000 angels, but yet he died for you and me. Thank you for everything you do. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Good morning again, church. Hey, great sermon, great communion. And we're going to close out this morning just with some announcements and some prayer concerns. The first one I want to share with you, we do our 10 for God and our neighbor each month. And I wanted to give you an update. This month was our youth group. And as you know, by now we're sending a lot of kids to camp and some summer programming. We've been doing a lot of stuff already this summer and have a lot more coming up. So I want to give you an update. You've given to date $630 towards this effort. Thank you for your generosity and give yourselves a round of applause for that. Because of that, we'll be able to send kids to camp and they'll be able to hear the good news of Jesus. And just simply put, life is different at camp. Camp changes lives. So thank you for that. If you still want to give, come see me or you can do that online. Also got a note in the mail from the Heaters. They've been gone for a little while. Started with vacation and then went out to go be with Ed's brother as unfortunately he passed last week. So we wanted to read this note to you from them. And it says, we're so thankful for your love and concern, as was demonstrated from your calls and cards as we went through COVID and the death of Ed's brother. Thank you lovingly, Ed and Priscilla. So we're going to continue to pray for you guys and to just be there for you as you're back. I want to tell you, Wednesday nights, we're still meeting. This week, Steve Kennedy is going to be leading Wednesday night at 7 in the Fellowship Hall, and we're studying the life of Job. So want to encourage you there. Coffee's good, by the way, family. The coffee is so good. So be there for that and enjoy some good fellowship and interaction there. want to go over some prayer requests. And as I always say, there's a lot, and there's a lot of they're pretty intense, but I wanted to just go through them with you and give you an idea of what some of our brothers and sisters are going through. So Tom Webb, his treatments are complete. He is cancer free. Got this picture. He's ringing the bell, and we better give that a round of applause. So we're going to continue to pray for him. His treatments are over, but he's going to be home for the next 30 days and just building up his immune system. So pray for him and Ruth. Continue praying for them. I want to ask for your prayers and give you an update on Brandy Tyler with her cancer and her battle there. Tomorrow they're going to put a feeding tube in. She's struggling to eat, but she's doing her best that she can, and she's we're asking for her, for prayers for her, for strength, and just that she'll continue to stay encouraged. And we're also doing another round of gift cards. I reached out to her and asked her what she's struggling with and what she needs help with. And you know, she's driving to Tampa sometimes three times a week and back. So if you'd like to give gift cards, she uses Wawa and Sam's Club a lot for gas, and you can give those to Wayne and Martha. Most importantly, we just need prayer warriors to step up. On behalf of everybody, but certainly for Brandy here. She's struggling with that. Also want to pray for Tracy Winkler and for Mary Jane Braddock as they're going through cancer and recovering through cancer, respectively, there. Need to let you know that Hilda Nino is in the hospital for a pacemaker. I believe she's in Advent. Is that right? So we need to continue to pray for her and just to be there for her. Mindy Erickson, which is Lorraine Mattern's daughter, having surgery later this week. Benita is still out, and she's recovering at home with a blood clot in her leg, and the doctors have a good eye on that. And we just want to reach out to Benita, continue to pray for Margie Childers out of the hospital. She fell a while back, and she's struggling with her shoulder. Lori Dyer. This was a prayer request turned in by Richard and Nancy Frost. That's their niece, and she was taken to the hospital with difficulty breathing. Had a heart cath on Monday. Is that right? Yep. And okay, so they found no results from the heart cath. We need to be praying for her, but for the doctors to be able to give some answers and maybe a path moving forward here. We've got Elaine Smith on the list. That's Hilda Hollinsworth's mother, being assessed for possible hospice care. And we're just asking for the prayers of strength for the family to get through this and just to surround Hilda as she's helping her mom. We want to pray for Rachel Witten. I was told the surgery went very successful from her stroke and the brain bleed. And hopefully she'll be released soon to rehab. But she is coherent, and I was told that she's not only just taking visits, but also doing FaceTime. So that might be a good way to encourage her. A lot of you guys know Ron Willits passed away Wednesday morning. Ron was the husband of Beverly Willits, and myself and Wayne Collier got to go visit with him on Monday and before he passed. And I just want to express on behalf of the family the thanks and the encouragement for both of them. So we need to pray for Beverly. Their service for Ron is going to be in Kokomo, Indiana. And so just pray as they travel. She wanted me to express that they just love Mary Camp so much. And thank you for that. Barbara Connerty tested positive for COVID earlier this week. We want to pray for Ray and Enid, not only just for their shoulder issues, but they're also traveling. I think they're in Rochester, New York right now for a funeral for a family member. And then we want to pray for Sarah Sigworth with her cancer. Elsie Jones, which is Teresa Kennedy's mother, was moved to hospice care. So we want to pray for her, but also pray for Teresa and just that God will continue to give her the strength that she needs. And I know that we need to be surrounding her with prayer. And then we want to pray for Eunice too, Eunice Massengill. Just I want to encourage us as a church family to step up and encourage her and reach out to her. So here's some of our shut-in list. But just trying to put those prayer requests before you, and we'll go ahead and go to God in prayer, and then Jordan's going to lead us in a closing song. Father, it's been a wonderful morning to get together and celebrate you as our Heavenly Father, but also to honor the fathers and the men in our lives that have stepped up as spiritual fathers. And Lord, I look around, I see so many men over the years that have invested into me and so many others. Lord, thank you for our dads. Thank you for our men. And as we honor them, Lord, just help them to know they're appreciated. Father, we've lifted up the names of so many people that we love and care about that are struggling. We've seen your mighty hand at work in the lives of everybody, but we know there's some that need healing and that it's only going to be at your hand, Lord. So we petition you, we cry out to you as a loving Father to heal and to act and on their behalf and to comfort and to give peace, Lord. We thank you for this church family. I thank you for just the opportunity to come together and worship and to learn from your word and to lift up in prayer and to commune together, Lord. As we depart, help us to always be about your business, just like Jesus was always about your business, Father. Help us to go make disciples. Help us to seek first the kingdom, to love our neighbors and our enemies, Father. Bless us as we go. Forgive us of our sins. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's be standing.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardoned for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine within thousand beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.